It ended in disappointment, but the Sunbirds made a great showing in Florida at the NCCAA National Tournaments. We'll be bringing you the highlights from those games, as well as a look at what the rest of the week brought our student athletes. Don't go anywhere, because it's all coming up right now on Inside Fresno Pacific Athletics. Hello and welcome to this week's edition of Inside Fresno Pacific Athletics. I'm your host, Katie Rocca. It was a successful fall semester as the Sunbirds completed their first season as a Division II member. Here are some of the high-speed, power-packed highlights from Fresno Pacific's inaugural adventure into the NCAA. Here with the highlights is Brandon Tripp.
The number one seeded Sunbirds taking on the number four seed Palm Beach Atlantic in the NCCAA semifinals. And this one was one for the history books. Early on, though, things looked grim. The Sailfish jumped out to an early 2-0 lead on chip goals over junior goalkeeper Fabian Ronhell. Late in the first half, and Paul Eastless nearly gets one back, but is unlucky as it goes off a defender, and the crisis is averted for PBA for now. At the break, head coach Jaime Ramirez reminded his team that they've been down and come back before. And in the second half, they did just that. After multiple near makes, the Sunbirds finally get one back on this Alvaro Nogales goal from senior midfielder Fabrizio Nazare. FPU down 2-1 and getting a lot of support from the volleyball team, who finished off a big one themselves earlier in the evening. Then Paul Islas comes up with a great cross into the box, and after a bit of a scrum, Luke Tyler finds an opening and puts it in the back of the net. We're all knotted up 2-2. After two overtimes, the score was unchanged, and so we would go to penalties for the first time this season. In the first session of PKs, Ronell comes up with the monster save, and it gave the Sunbirds a chance to get an early cushion. Nazare provided that cushion here. He completely fools the keeper and remained perfect for the season on penalties, and FPU took a 1-0 lead in PKs. Then Palm Beach Atlantic, looking to equalize, gets one to go and in as Ronell guesses the wrong way. Nogales up next, and boy did he put this one away. Left-footed shot on a rope somewhere back up 2-1. The Sailfish will put another one in, and so Gustavo Silva looking to keep pace and does just that as the keeper guesses right but can't get there in time. FPU up 3-2. Then it was up to Kenny Hogg, the NCCAA leading goal scorer, and he lived up to the billing, slotting one away to tie it back up. Alexis Hernandez now on the spot, and he puts it away. And it all came down to Charlie Hubbard, who needed to make this PK to keep PBA alive, and he does with a laser shot opposite Ronell. We are all knotted up at 4, and with nervous teammates looking on, Rodrigo Viana stepped up to the spot.
What I like about this group is that we made sure that we didn't lose our composure. It's one of those things where if you draw analogies, you know, to boxing and you get stunned a little bit and you know, you don't get knocked out. You go back and you go to the corner and you get your, you know, you catch your breath and you get that opportunity in the second half like we did, being down 2-0. We talked about the fact that we were down 1-0 before, that we have experienced this. And in fact, it was asked of us prior to coming to this tournament, you know, what's going to happen when you guys go down, if you were to go down, which is unfamiliar territory for you. And we did it with one goal down against Azusa and came back and won 3-1. You know, we did it here with two goals down and came back and tied it.
You know, we were kind of team that we are used to putting 1-2 goals away in the very beginning of the game, and there was something unusual. You know, we didn't know how to handle it, but it showed our character. We are kind of team that we can get a score on and we can go back, and then we can get a win, and that's why we are here in Florida.
But we knew we could do it. You know, we're a team, we work hard, our chemistry is so good, and honestly it took, you know, everybody's energy for us to, you know, to go through and win this game all together.
I did what I've been practicing, you know, throughout the year we've been practicing PK, and that's why, you know, like we got a win tonight.
I'm so happy for Rodrigo Viana to have won it for us, but equally of importance is the rest of the guys that stepped up and took the penalties, and then the first save by Fabian was huge, because that put the pressure on them, and to their credit, they put away the next four. But I tell you, I've not been in a game myself as a coach this dramatic and exciting in terms of having all five kickers come through and put their penalty kick away the way that they did today. They were money.
I gotta give thanks to my team for having that for trusting me. You know, having that trust on me really helped me, you know.
When it's all said and done, the boys performed. They got it done in one of the most exciting and unusual ways for us that I think will be remembered for a long, long time.
The Sunbirds looking to cap off a perfect NCAA title run against a familiar foe in California Baptist, and the Sunbirds were off and running quickly. Gustavo Silva here with a great cross, finds Alvaro Nogales, who puts it in the top shelf pass keeper Joey Pacheco, and the Sunbirds took an early 1-0 lead. They have scored in the first 6 minutes each of their three matches against California Baptist this season. And then later in the half, the Sunbirds with another chance. Paul Islas can't get the ball to settle, though, and it dribbles out of bounds. And the Sunbirds would remain up by one. And California Baptist with the opportunity on the other end as Alex Anderson finds a hole in the defense, but he can't find the right touch, and it goes out wide. Crisis averted for the Sunbirds. And then just before halftime, Paul Islas one more time trying to get the outside shot to bend in, and it curves just around the post. The Sunbirds go up into the half 1-0. And then out of the break, Bruno Pessoa forces the turnover that finds Paul Islas, who gets around the defense and beats Pacheco for the goal, his first of the night and the 55th of his career. That puts him third all-time alone past head coach Jaime Ramirez in goals scored for a career. So the Sunbirds with a 2-0 lead looking to make it 3-0, and Paul Islas on the breakaway is taken out by the keeper Joey Pacheco, who was shown just a yellow card, and Islas was severely injured on the play. He would come back in late in the match. And then the Lancers with the opportunity here, and Alex Anderson puts one in and gives CBU some life. They're down 2-1. And then in the 82nd minute, Michael Salazar with the corner kick, and it finds Paul Oliver, who puts it past keeper Fabian Rangel, and the match is all tied up at two. And then in the final seconds, Alex Anderson is able to beat Rangel and find Mark Hope wide open in the middle of the field, and he puts it in the back of the net. The Lancers, with the last second goal, go on to win back-to-back NCCAA titles, and the Sunbirds close out their season 18-5.
It was a fantastic match. I think it was a match worthy of its label. You're in a national championship final, and both teams are doing everything they can to do the job and to get it done. And we started off doing well. We scored and we got a second one, and I just felt right at the point where we were close to getting the third one. Paul got hurt, and that hurts. That hurts when you have your go-to guy go down on a controversial call, because it's unfortunate that the goalkeeper didn't get a red card, and puts us in a very difficult situation. In terms of continuing our attack and having the opportunities to do that. There will be challenges that will test your character. My hope is that our guys will learn from this experience, that we will have an opportunity to get back into this tournament next year. And hopefully we'll continue to improve and get better. We're going to miss our seniors. They did a fantastic job, and I thought they were on their way today. I really felt like the game was under control. After the two goals, they were obligated to come at us, and they did a very good job. So I don't think we sat on the lead. I just think they really stepped it up, and my hat's off to them. Ryan has a good group, and my heart goes out to our guys. My heart goes out to our guys and to our program, because this is the fourth time that we lost in national championship final, and we still got to continue to work hard and improve. But I'm as proud as can be. This is one of those games where in soccer you say the boys left it all out on the field, and they did. And so I'm hurting for them. I'm hurting with them. But at the same time, we have to be men and be able to accept the result as well.
The Sunbirds, after completing a perfect pool play, looking to advance to the national finals against Shorter University, and this one came down to the wire. Jumping ahead the third set with the match tied, and Shorter finishes it off to go ahead 2-1 on the Sunbirds. But in the fourth, FPU came back with a fury. First, the monster kill here by Hoopia Inc. She would finish the match with 20 kills in 5 sets. And then NCCAA National Player of the Year Erica Adachi with the point to give Fresno Pacific a 3-2 advantage. Then take a look at this play. Hannah Butler with the amazing dig, and Kaylee Allen and Hoopia Inc. get it back over. And after an attack error by Shorter, The Sunbirds are rewarded with an 8-4 lead and all the momentum headed their way. And then Adachi with the killer service ace. She had a double-double on the night in her final match as a Sunbird. Then to finish off the set, Kara Mitchell with the kill. And the Sunbirds knotted up at 2-2 in the fifth set. And right off the bat, Michaela Tucker, the freshman, with the set from Adachi. And she throws down a huge kill to give FPU the early lead. Then Kathleen Anderson with the outside hit gives the Sunbirds a 3-1 lead. But then Jasmine Crook with the kill off the block gives Shorter some life. They would go on a big run to take a 10-9 lead, and then at 13-9, Ink can't handle the serve, and that would set up this match point. Crook again with the winner, and the match as number 2 Shorter upsets the number 1 seeded Sunbirds, who finished the year 28-4 and ranked number 10 in their first year in the NCAA.
I think our ball control and our offense really came through. Defensively, we did really, really well, and we were strong. They were able to find cracks in us in the other sets, and in sets 2 and 4, we just stopped them. You know, our block did a really nice job, and then our defense picked up all the balls around them. And serving, we did a really nice job on serving, and made them, you know, kind of back off and kept them out of system. And just did a really nice job of keeping the momentum, because this match was all about momentum, and whoever had that momentum was usually the one on top. And 2 and 4, we definitely had the momentum. You know, it's tough to talk about what we could have done better, because, you know, it was so close that it could have been any one or two little things. You know, it just makes a little bit of a difference, and, you know, we could have dug that ball, or we could have, you know, served that point in, and that might have been the difference. So all it is with volleyball is just a couple points and that thing turns around. And so, yeah, we definitely could have cleaned things up. We could have played a little bit better, but I'm so proud of the girls' effort and what they put out there. They put everything out there. I mean, this is an exhausting tournament, and you could tell, you know, by the way they were playing, that they were tired. And we just kept saying, you know, commit to this match, and they did. They fully committed to it, put everything into it, and you know, we didn't come out on top. Shorter played amazing. You got to hand it to them. I mean, their libero was outstanding. Their number 2 outside hitter was amazing. You know, they did a really, really nice job of staying in the play and just keep coming back at us. You know, we've got a young group coming up, and they're going to learn from this, and they're going to be a lot better for it, because, you know, we're a talented team, and they played really well, but we want to be better. And they've already said, you know, they're going to commit to the spring and get that much better so they can be ready to go and be that much better of a team next year.
The Sunbirds looking to rebound from a big loss at California Baptist on Wednesday, taking on Bethesda in non-conference action, and the Sunbirds were all over this one. First possession of the game, and John Taylor with the sweet dime to Ricky Vick. The Sunbirds had 25 assists on the night, their highest total of the season. Very next play, FU applying the pressure, getting the turnover, and Taylor finds Vick again, this time in transition. He finished with 6 assists on the night. Then more great ball movement from the Sunbirds as Malcolm Griffin finds Antonio Credit in the paint for the jam. Late in the first half, and John Taylor getting it done on the scoring end, as he always does with the fadeaway step back here, part of his team-leading 21 on the night for Bethesda. It was all about Ralph Monday, the bucket here, part of his game-high 22, and that would be about all the offense the Flames would get. Just before half, Taylor with the no-look pass to Credit, who gives the Flames the pump fake and lays it in. He finished with 11 on the night. Then in the second half, Monday can't finish in the lane, and Griffin on the break. He drives and kicks to Vick, who nails the three. Vick finished with 13 points on the night. Then Anthony Brandt finds the range 3 of his 6, and the Sunbirds win big 87-54.
It's amazing what happens, you know, as a team when you move the basketball. You get easier shots, and, you know, scoring is more spread out. So I thought it was really good for us. You know, I liked how Anthony Brandt looked for his own shot tonight. If we can get him going, that's going to be a huge help for us, because he's a good player, you know, and hasn't played particularly well on the offensive end so far. I still thought they got too many open shots. You know, our talk and communication defensively is not where it needs to be. Yeah, we were a little bit more solid, but, you know, being at home, you know, against a team like Bethesda is what we should have done. So it's hard to be too positive about that. But, you know, again, glad we got the win, and, you know, hopefully we got a little better tonight.
Neither Sunbird basketball squad was able to find a win in their first PacWest game, as both teams fell to California Baptist. The women kept it close in the first half, but fell behind early in the second en route to an 83-67 loss to the Lancers. Kira White had 32 points for the Sunbirds, who are still looking for their first win of the season. On Tuesday, the men made the trip to Riverside and were close until the final 10 minutes when Cal Baptist was able to pull away for a 93-75 win over Fresno Pacific. Matt Samuels led the way for FPU in scoring for the first time this season with 19 points. John Taylor added 17, scoring under 20 points for the first time this season. Despite walking away without a national title, the Sunbirds have gotten plenty of national attention over the last week. Both Erica Adachi and Hoopia Inc. were named to the NCCAA All-American team, and Adachi was named to the NCCAA National Player of the Year and Tournament MVP. Senior forward Paul Eastless was named an NSCAA third-team All-American in his final season with Fresno Pacific. Eastless scored 22 goals this season, which was good enough to pass head coach Jaime Ramirez for third all-time in goals scored. Even though the semester is coming to a close, there will still be tons of games and matches for you to get out there and support Fresno Pacific Athletics. This Saturday afternoon, Dixie State will be traveling here to Fresno to take on your Sunbird basketball teams. The women's game begins at 2:30 p.m. and the men play at 4:30 p.m. The Sunbirds will be sponsoring Toys for Tots. All fans are encouraged to bring a toy for a child in need this Christmas in lieu of admission. Kids can also take photos with Santa during the game. Swimming will be taking a 6-hour bus ride over to Las Vegas for the UNLV Invite December 15th through the 17th. The swim meet will be a test of both physical and mental strength, and we wish Josh Christensen and the team the best of luck. Remember, you can stay up to date with all the latest news, scores, and highlights for the Sunbirds at fpuathletics.com and on Twitter at fpusunbirds. Glad you could join us this week. Have a Merry Christmas, Happy New Year, and we'll see you next year right here on Inside Fresno Pacific Athletics.